How you doing, everybody? My name is Dean Olson. I am a songwriter, radio host, and producer from Orange County, California. And I'm really just an average guy who loves to make music. However, when I get behind a microphone, I become the strong writer on the radio, helping songwriters and artists keep musically fit. The way I love to do that is through faith and hope and encouragement, by taking in the stories and experiences told to me by my wonderful guests, and by learning from the best in the business and passing it along to you. And now, I want to welcome you to another beautiful day for a fantastic show. It is 2022 and a brand new season, and I am excited to be kicking things off with a very special musical guest right here, right now. This beautiful woman you're seeing on the screen with me is singer Carla Williams. Her bio also lists her as a Mobile, Alabama native, mother of four, model, entrepreneur. And when we finish this episode, I hope I can also call her my friend, because that's what I'm all about on this show. And I really have been enjoying Carla's new album titled A Tribute to the Carpenters. Just came out January 28th, 2.5 years in the making, but it is now available for all of us to enjoy. And we don't have a lot of time, so I want to welcome to the show with open arms a very talented lady, Carla Williams.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Glad to be here today.
Thanks for, I understand. Yeah, I thought I was going to have a little more time with you, but I'll see if I can choke out these questions. There's so much to cover here.
You have there a wonderful, is. It's a big project.
You have a wonderful project that you, your album is out now. Did you ever dream back in 2009 or whenever this all got started that today in 2022, you'd be releasing a sophisticated album project such as this with some renowned guest artists? I mean, you must be on top of the world.
No pun intended, huh?
Yeah, well, that was intended. But how does it feel to be at this point? I'm sure this isn't the end of the road, but I bet right. You this is a lot of fun, huh?
It is. And I tell you, it's been probably the most surreal moment of my life in this music career. And no, back in 2009, I would have never guessed in a million years that I would be doing this right now at this caliber. You know, had an incredible first album, worked with some of the best of the best, which just kind of transitioned me into being prepared, you know, for an album.
What was the first album? What was it called?
It was called I'm Home.
Uh-huh. I'm sorry, I'm talking over you. I apologize.
That's okay. That's
I'm all jacked up now because I need to speed up the show a little bit. You had a song called Mobile, was it called Mobile? Just that called one, Mobile. That one word. Yeah.
Yep, called Mobile.
You hail from there. Were you born and raised in?
Born and raised and still full time live here.
Okay. So you're like lower Dixie Bayou country then, I guess.
That's it. Mobile.
Yeah. my dad had a friend. So we visited them in Mobile a lot. So,
what a small world.
When I was very young. So I remember what we were able to pile in the car. I didn't drive around. Everything was all under their rules. And
right.
There used to be a place called Skyline Country Club. I think they changed the name of it. And we used to go visit there. And then we were going to go down to Dolphin Island and all these other little places.
Oh, wow.
And, did you ever do any of that stuff? Did you ever
Absolutely.
To the
My
shore?
Kids still love Dolphin Island. That's a big hot spot for the younger generation. And just a lot of good times there and being out on the boat, being in the water, which is what we all love so much.
Yeah. I understand that's where Mardi Gras started out there. You know, everybody associates it with New Orleans, but it's Mobile where it kind of.
Mobile is where it started. That's still a big fight between us and New Orleans.
Is it really? Well, they're not too far away from each other, right?
We're not far at all. Less than 2 hours. And, we do great Mardi Gras down here. We're super excited. You know, we kind of have been delayed over the last couple of years and not getting to do as much as we would like to because of COVID. So we're ready to jump right back into it.
Let me ask you about that. Since you mentioned COVID, 2.5 years to, from start to finish, I think, give or take. Right. But what was that like? I mean, that's sort of a tiny handicap, right when it started COVID was probably when you were getting going on this recording. How'd that all go?
We started really getting into the groove of this in December of 2019. You're talking about it was the beginning of it. And, we just kept rocking and rolling. You know, we all just really dove in. We did the best we could. We got together when we could get together. We, we just made it happen. We really never stopped, and it worked out beautifully, fortunately enough for us to go ahead and get as much wrapped up as we could.
Yeah. I've been looking at a little bit of the credits. I like creating albums. I love watching the whole process take shape, and you got to give credit to everybody on the project.
That's exactly right.
It looks like a lot of credit goes to Tom, your producer.
Right.
Because he is quite the talent. I see him all over this thing, right? So
he's been an incredible producer. He's an incredible friend. He is an unbelievable musician. I've never seen a guitar player quite like him. So when he and Lukather partnered up on Goodbye to Love, quite the show, quite incredible. So he's talented all the way around.
You gave a little sneak peek into some of your guests. So I'll get that in just a second, but yeah, a little bit more about Tom. Is he responsible for chasing out all these incredible artists like Steve and Bill Champlin and some of these other heavyweights? I mean, these are legendary guys on your project.
Yes, he is. Tom is the one that's had so many wonderful connections over the years in music. And, you know, those connections lead to other connections, lead to other connections. And it just all, the collaboration on this album has been phenomenal. And so, Tom is definitely the ringleader of making the majority of this album happening.
That's kind of what you pay a producer for, I guess, you know.
That's right.
Yeah, so I believe you get your money's worth. You really did quite a nice job on this thing. Whose brainchild was this whole tribute album? You know, why the Carpenters? Was it your idea, or did they sort of said, what would you think? You know, let me in on that a little bit.
Right. Well, when I did my first album almost 15 years ago now, Steve Dorff was my first producer. And he... Okay. You know, working with him and being in the studio with him, he just came to me at the tail end of recording, and he said, you know, I've worked with Karen Carpenter before. And, you know, of course, I was familiar with the Carpenters. She was, you know, they were before my time, but but very familiar. My parents played the Carpenters. My favorite Christmas song of all time has always been Merry Christmas, Darling, even as a little girl. And so he's the first one that made the comment, you know, has anybody ever told you that you sound, you know, similar to Karen Carpenter, same vocal tones, same octave, same range, same everything. And at that time, I said no. At that time, I didn't realize what an honor that was for someone to say that to me. And then you fast forward to, goodness, about 12 and a half years ago, and Michael O'Mardian is the one that we were on a TV show together performing, and he said the exact same thing. Has anyone ever told you that you sound like Karen Carpenter? And I said, as a matter of fact, they have. And that's where the conversation began, and my life changed from that day on.
Wow. Now, is everybody agreeing? I mean, do you sound like that? Sound like Karen to all these people that are listening to your new album?
You know, and it's funny. I when this came out and all over social media, I mean, it has been, you get a little nervous of, you know, well, you know, who's going to be that one that says somebody, you know, she doesn't sound like Karen Carpenter. And I would say out of thousands and thousands of comments that we have received across the board, whether it was on, you know, Sir Cliff Richard's page and his social medias anybody, Billy Dean's page and so many of these guest artists on here. There's been one person out of thousands that has said, I mean, I don't really think she sounds like her that much. But other than that, I mean,
I was the one that did that. I'm sorry.
Right. And we all laughed about it. As we all say, there's always one. So,
let me tell you something.
Other than that, it's been incredible. It's been so well received. And the comments and it's been unbelievable.
Well, let me tell you something. You do have a gorgeous, a beautiful voice. Very kind of the same range. Yeah. Like you were saying. It's a little lower pitch than you're talking right now. Karen sort of talked in the same tone that you talk in. And then there are times where you'll hear it, but I'm really glad that you aren't trying to do an impression of her. I think you should have your own unique sound, but it's nice that you have the chops to handle those songs, because those are big shoes to fill. And all those Karen Carpenter fans are going like, you can't do that. You're not my mom. Or, you know, they're just like, you can't do it. But you know what? It's very brave of you to take on that thing and pull it off in such a way that you did, because this came out very nice.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I hope I got the compliment in there. I don't want you to take it.
You did.
I'm trying to be as honest as I can. Yes, at first I was going, because you start off the album, track number one is the one that Anne Murray made more famous, I Just Fall in Love.
That's
again.
Right. And Dusty Springfield also had recorded
that. That's true, yeah.
Dreaming, I must be dreaming. Or am I really lying here with you? sleepy. You take me in your arms, and though I'm wide awake, I know my dream is coming true. And oh, I just fall in love again. Just one touch and then it happens every time. And there I can't help myself, I fall in love with you. Magic, it must be magic. The way I hold you in the night just seems to fly. For you to take me to a star, heaven is that moment when I look into your eyes. And oh, I just fall in love again. Just one touch and then it happens every time. And there I go, myself, I fall in love with you. I fall in love with you. I can't help myself. I fall in love with you.
As a matter of fact, most of these things, I mean, when you set aside the ones that Richard Carpenter was famous for arranging and basically writing them up, all the other songwriters, I was amazed how many people I had met. I met Steve Dorff that you were talking about. I keep saying Steven because it's his kid.
His son, yeah.
I met him that one time, and very nice man, Steve. And we talked about some of his songs, and I'm glad that he was your first producer. It sounds like that was a good entree into the music biz.
Absolutely.
For you.
Absolutely. Yeah. And he, as you were making reference to at the beginning of this, I will always give credit where credit's due. Yeah. And that's so important to me, because if you look at someone like him and the co-producer on that album, Milton Brown, if it weren't for those two guys, I wouldn't be here right now. And they're still so much a part of my journey and still my biggest cheerleaders. And so that's really such a really cool thing for me.
Yeah. Whole thing just makes me like sit up and take notice. I can appreciate the technical aspects, and I can appreciate the arranging, all the strings and the different.
Yes.
When you have lived with these songs for 50 years or so, you tend to criticize anything that's covering them, you know?
Right.
And I'm glad that you didn't try to copy every single one note for note. It sounds like these sound incredible, especially a couple that I can mention in just a second. I want to speed it up here, but okay, let me take a deep breath. Go for it. Belfriar Records, what is that? Is that something you came up with, or is this a label that you signed on to? Is this your own label?
It's my label. Yeah, okay. It's my label, Southern Bells down here. And everybody always has called me that because of my, as y'all can probably hear, this very very Southern accent that I have. Uh-huh. And I've always been considered a fiery personality, you know, just never meet a stranger, love everybody. So yeah. They just kind of put, actually my old manager at Lofton Creek Records, which is where I signed my first record deal. And when Lofton Creek closed, Mark was the one that suggested and that I opened up my own label and start releasing my music off my own label, which is exactly what I did. It's been a brilliant move. And so Mark is the one that, you know, we were kind of tossing names around, and he's the one that actually came up with Belfriar.
Basically an independent label.
Yes.
Then. Oh, great. That's the best way to be in this
absolutely.
Day and age.
Absolutely. You know? Yeah. Absolutely.
Well, the Lofton Creek thing, when were you excited when you first signed on to that label? Was it a big deal for you?
Oh my God, it was such a big deal for me because I was 30 years old, which is unheard of at uh-huh. that time. And that's, you know, as everybody says, a little bit older in the industry that people normally sign an artist on. And, you know, when I signed with Lofton Creek and with Mike Borchetta heading that camp, and, you know, the Borchetta name is so, so big in Nashville. And, you know, it was just the perfect match for me. It was just a beautiful relationship. We did some wonderful things together, winning a big award out in Los Angeles. And so it was very, another surreal moment for me.
What was the award in Los Angeles? It was like New Artist, something like that?
It was at the New Music Awards. It was Female Country Artist of the Year.
That's wonderful.
Yeah.
It's always good to have a nice award. And then you were in, you got to visit LA then. So that must have been fun.
That's
too.
That's right.
couple things. It listed you as a model. I'll just cover that super quick. You got to do that at least for your photo shoot. I liked all the photos in the album and everything. So that's that's nice. Girls love to pose for pictures, and that's fun.
Right.
Was it a lot
right,
of work?
Lot
did,
of
you, did you know dressing up and getting the right look and then posing with the guitar and, you know, and all that stuff fun, or was it a little bit stressful?
Yeah. You know, as I always tell, and I have some phenomenal photographers, and I have some here in Mobile. I have some amazing ones in in Nashville.
Yeah.
And I actually worked with one in Los Angeles too. But, you know, I always say that photo shoot day is the most stressful day of the year for me, because it is. It's all about that what you're trying to portray. What is that the right outfit? Is it the right look? Is it the right this? And I knew that this Carpenters album had to be very special. And it was not that I wanted to go full blown retro, you know, but it was more of kind of scale that back a bit, be myself, kind of throw that flair into it just a bit, maybe with the bell bottom jeans, the platform shoe. But, you know, it's modeling's been a part of my life since I was a young child. So it's very comfortable for me. But just I think it's more the preparation of a photo shoot is what's so stressful for me.
Yeah.
So, and I do it with my girls. I mean, I have two of my daughters are models, and I do it with them too. I stress out over their photo shoots or what
goodness.
They're going to wear.
Yeah.
So,
social media, I think I saw one of your girls is a singer too. She sings.
She is. She released her first single back in May.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Following in mama's footsteps. That's a great thing.
Such a feeling's coming over me. There is wonder in most everything I see. Not a cloud in the sky, got the sun in my eyes, and I won't be surprised if it's a dream. Everything I want the world to be is now coming true, especially for me. And the reason is clear, it's because you are here. You're the nearest thing to heaven that I've seen. I'm on the top of the world looking down on creation, and the only explanation I can find is the love that I've found ever since you've been around. Your love's put me at the top of the world. Something in the wind has learned my name, and it's telling me that things are not the same. In the leaves on the trees and the touch of the breeze, there's a pleasing sense of happiness for me. There is only one wish on my mind. When this day is through, I hope that I will find that top of the world. Your love's put me at the top of the world.
A little bit more about your personal life. Yeah, I see all these things. I have four kids. My wife and I were discussing because I was just glowing on about you about how I like this album, and then she wanted a little bit more, know a little bit more. And I said, when I was reading the the little press release, the bio on you, and I go, yeah, I see you had three kids when you started. Now you have a fourth.
Right.
And where's husband or dad? Is he in the picture? Or is he in the background all the time?
He very much is.
Good. Is he like running things while you run
that's
around and
right.
sing?
No. Well, my two oldest girls are in college, okay. And I have a son that's a junior in high school, and then my little one is in the fifth grade. Okay. But no, he is very much around. He keeps this. He keeps us all moving and grooving. We own a research and development company. He's a clinical research scientist.
Really?
So he is busy in his own right.
Holy
so,
mackerel.
Yeah.
You too. You six, actually. I mean, is that how many
that's
people
right.
in the family? You got to.
That's right.
Going out to dinner must be crazy unless you just eat in.
Well,
all the
it's
time.
A lot of fun. It's never a dull moment. I can say that.
Well, and now you, I'm not going to say on the side, but you run your own like company, Innovative Medical Products or something
Innovative
like
Medicine
that.
Innovative Medicine
Partners. Yeah.
And that's my husband actually is the, he's the ringleader there.
Okay.
Run the operations of it. I co-own the company, and it's an amazing, amazing company to be a part of. Being in operations my whole life, stepping into this with him and with two of our partners, has just been phenomenal. It's so amazing for me to watch, the world of medicine changing on a daily basis for the better. And it's incredible.
Brag about that for about 15 seconds. What do you guys do? What do you and your husband do?
We are a medical device company. So we take physicians' concepts and we turn it into a patented, regulated, FDA-approved device. And so we put that on the market. So we have a huge industry in infertility. So it's been quite a beautiful journey for us with this of a lot of families that have tried to have babies for many years that were not able to. Our devices help them. We have multiple births that have taken place. We have multiple people that are pregnant currently. So it's just been it's beautiful. And absolutely very blessed to be a part of something like
God
that.
God bless you. That's wonderful that you're doing that. All these people. Another thing, are you partnered up or affiliated with Young at Heart over in Nashville?
Chris Denton. Okay. Yes, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah. When you look on Wikipedia or something like that, you always see like, personal life, what's going on with Carla? But there is no Wikipedia on you. So
I haven't gotten there just yet.
Let me sum it up. You're from Mobile, Alabama. You live now in Nashville, right? For how long?
I go back and forth. I'm still primarily here in Mobile, but we do have a home in Nashville as well. So I'm back and forth about every other week.
School, first memory that music was important to you. Was it before you got into school or anything like that?
Definitely.
Can you remember?
It started when I was three. As I tell, I laugh and tell everybody, all of us Southerners down here definitely got our start in church. And I was on stage at 3 years old singing my first solo in church at my hometown church. And the love of that just continued and sang all through high school, went to to college on vocal scholarship. And it just transitioned to that. And I just always loved it. It's just always been a passion for me, just full blown passion. It's almost like therapy for me. I just love it that much.
That's wonderful. Boy, this is almost like a fairy tale in real life. That's working out just fine. Four kids, nothing going wrong. No struggles, right? None of this was ever hard for you, I suppose, trying to get into the music biz.
I can honestly say, and I'm one of the few that can probably honestly say this, when I tell you that I've been blessed along the way, I mean, everything just continued to fall into place.
Okay.
And I took a five to six year break. And I thought, I'm probably ruining my chance of jumping right back into it because I just needed to be mom. I just still did a lot of charity work and I did things locally, but out, doing big things, I was not. It was just a crucial time in my kid's life, being younger, and I just needed to be there all the time. And, and the second that I decided to jump back into it, I did. And I, again, was welcomed with open arms all over again. And it has just been unbelievable to me, the acceptance that I have received. Now I'm 44 years old and I'm still being welcomed with open arms into this industry. And and especially now, just reaching this demographic with this album has just been phenomenal for me.
Oh. Well, thank you for saying your age. I would have bleeped it out if you want me to, but that's nice.
Oh, no, I'm very proud of my age.
I am too. This is wonderful. I didn't realize that. yeah, you still have a lot of road to come up.
I do.
Speaking of road, when you're visiting, now this is something that I have to get in here so we can let you know that part of this album was recorded. You actually went over to UK and to Abbey Road Studios?
We did. We went to London. Mm-hmm. Myself, Tom Hemby, and Michael O'Mardian went over to London and recorded. Okay. We tracked, we did put strings on four of the sides. Wow. At Abbey Road.
Mm-hmm. Boy, he's got some deep pockets, this Tom, I guess. You know, that cannot be cheap going to Abbey Road. That's so prestigious.
No, I have the deep pockets.
Yeah. Oh, well, no, I don't.
Project. When you ask about my husband, bless his heart, that's what he's doing. No. This is a family-funded project.
I was playing dummy a little bit there. I understand that, you know, it takes a lot. And it's very hard when I'm glad that you're admitting that you got to pay out that thing, because it's not easy. And you have to expect that there's not really the big ROI on this kind of thing.
Right. No, absolutely.
You know, it's more of a labor of love. And look, I'm glad that you have that part of it to show for it, because this has turned into a nice work of art for you. Something you can absolutely be very proud of for years. So were you able to take your kids, your family then? Or was it just you and...
Well, I don't know. It was just three of us. It was such a quick trip. We didn't get to really stay and visit like we wanted to. We had so much going on. And we're very surprised that we even found the little slot of time. And not to mention, Abbey Road just had that one time slot. So we jumped in on it. Uh-huh. So, but I can't wait to take the kids back one day. Yeah. To kind of see that. And
are they excited and interested in your musical journey, your career?
They are, especially my two younger daughters. And of course, they're all my big fans. They're all my big cheerleaders. I have three girls and one boy. And, you know, my second daughter in line, she's a commercial music major at Lipscomb University in Nashville. My little one is a theater. She's in theater. She sings. But even my oldest daughter, and my son, I mean, they just love it. They love it. They love to see the biggest thing with them. I feel like I've done something right with them. They just love to see me happy. They love to see me succeed. They love to see me living a dream that a lot of moms don't get to live at this point in life.
Oh,
so
yeah.
They are pretty incredible children.
Let me talk real quick about just a couple of the songs at random. First of all, Cliff Richard. Now, this is a big deal. When we were talking about all the talent that you have on there, I mean, we're talking about a guy 60 years under his belt. And, right. You know, this is a guy I grew up with. I'm much older than you are. And 250 million records this guy sold worldwide. He's number three behind the Beatles and Elvis in singles, at least on that side of the pond. And so you were working with a legend. I mean, this is all my teenage years with him. Yeah.
You would never know it. Walking into, we were at Criteria Studios in Miami, which is where Cliff and I met for the first time. And he is the most humble, kindest human I have ever met in my life. You would never know that he was as successful. You would never know that he was world renowned. You mean, you would just never know it. He is just, he makes you feel like, it's genuine. I mean, he was telling me, I'm so honored to be on your album. As many times as I said, I'm so honored that you took the time to do this. And he's just been such a beautiful soul to get to know and to work with. And his whole team has just been wonderful. So yeah. he is a lovely person.
I was going to say the kids don't know who he is, but I was just looking up something. Did you know that he had somebody put out a calendar of Cliff Richard, you know?
Like, yes.
And he beat out all these pop stars, like, way younger than he is.
Yes.
Those little punks. That was cool. I had no idea.
It was funny because it was a big joke when I met him. He turned 81 in October of 21.
Right.
And, I walked in, I was like, gosh, you know, you look younger than I do. And it was just, he's just still so spunky, and you would never know that he was 81 years old, and he's just great. He is so wonderful.
He does the song Hurting Each Other with you.
Yes.
Wonderful duet. And he's still on pitch. You duet, wonderful chemistry, the two voices of you coming together. You can tell in his voice, he's aged a little bit in the way he used to sound, but he still sounds
great.
His voice still sounds strong. You know, very jealous and very happy for you. But and again, I'm not going to sing with Cliff Richard. So.
No one in the world ever had a love as sweet as my love. For no in the world could there be a boy as true as you, love. Oh my.
closer than the leaves on a weeping willow, baby. We are, yeah.
Closer, dear, are we,
oh, yeah,
than the simple letters A and B are.
All my life I could love only you.
All your life you could love only me. Tell me why then, oh, why should it be that we go on hurting each other?
Did a great job. Gosh, there's so many things I wanted to compliment you on, but Steve Lukather, that's a great, if you had to pick somebody, that's a good one to show off and do the solo on that one song that he did. Let me see, what was that song?
It was Goodbye to Love.
There you go. Goodbye to Love. And he did, he gave you two good tries at it, you know, like a minute and a half in, he does the regular one, and then they plays out the rest to the fade.
So he's such an incredible musician. So, it was funny when Tom came to me and said that Lukather was, you know, interested in doing this because he's such a huge Carpenter fan. I was a little floored by that. You know, you look at somebody that, you know, that is the type of music that he plays and all of that. And, but he does, he was just honored to be a part of this. And so I'm honored that he decided to do it.
I'll say goodbye to love. No one ever cared if I should live or die. Time and time again, the chance for love has passed me by, and all I know of love is how to live without it. I just can't seem to find it. So I made my mind up, I must live my life alone. And though it's not the easy way, I guess I've always known I'd say goodbye to love. There are no tomorrows for this heart of mine. Surely time will lose these bitter memories, and I'll find that there is someone to believe in and to live for. Something I could live for. All the years of useless search have finally reached an end. Loneliness and empty days will be my only friend. From this day, love is forgotten. I'll go on as best I can. Say goodbye to love.
Anyway, one more thing. Merry Christmas, darling. Quickly tell me about that, because, you know, you were smart to put that in the rotation, because, you know, you can pull that out every Christmas now.
That's right.
And then, you know, brag about it to your new fans and everything. Billy Dean, where is he coming in the thing? I'm too busy concentrating on your voice and I don't hear any of him. Where is he in this whole thing?
When we decided to figure out how are we going to launch into this album coming out, what is going to be, you know, we've got all these big names and we've got a lot going on, but what's going to be the big one? You know, as I always tell my team, I want fireworks. I always want fireworks. And they laugh about that because I do. I think outside of the box, what is it that's going to make this different? And we thought, well, you know, the timing's great for a Christmas song to come out. Merry Christmas, Darling, as far as we know, had never been done as a duet before. Mm-hmm. And so we thought, well, let's give it a shot. And then we did. And it turned out better than we could have ever imagined. Billy was actually introduced to me by a guy that was working on the project at the time. And you know, again, it's one of those things, these guys are so busy and they don't need to come work on my projects, but they all so graciously did. Mm-hmm. And Billy and I just hit it off from day one. We just instantly, voices, personalities, you know, as if I had known Billy my whole life and as if we had sang together for 20 years, you know, so it just worked out so brilliantly. And then we ended up doing the music concept video and that turned out great as well. So it was very received, you know, was received so well by everyone across the board. So it was a lot of fun.
Great. I'm glad. And you did a nice job.
Greeting cards have all been sent.
And the Christmas rush is through.
But I still have one wish to make.
A special one for you.
Merry Christmas, darling.
Merry Christmas, darling.
We're apart, that's true. But I can dream, and in my dreams, I'm Christmasing with you.
With you. Holidays are joyful. There's always something new. But every day's a holiday.
Christmas, darling.
Bill Champlin, since we were talking about all those guests, was he in the room? Were all these people in the room when you did this, or did they track somewhere else to do all this?
Bill Champlin did track somewhere else.
Okay.
He did We've Only Just Begun, you know, some of the backgrounds on We've Only Just Begun. Yeah. So he did track somewhere else. And so we, but he and Jeff Coffey, another
former
of Chicago was on.
Oh, they were both on the same track. So mm-hmm. you got two Chicago
and
alumni.
Right. And then Jeff Coffey and I did Close to You. So he did backgrounds on that. And I did not get to meet either one of them ahead of time. But crazy enough, Jeff Coffey was in concert here in Mobile just a few weeks ago. And we got to meet for the first time. And he pulled me up and we got to sing Close to You together. So that was a very special, very, very special time for me.
That was very cool. Now, people listening to this, they're going to have to track that. I mean, they're going to have to put on We've Only Just Begun, because You're gonna be shocked at first when Bill Champlin putting his little spin on there. He's always such a
undeniable.
He's like a keyboard wizard. So I'm like, I dug it. I thought it was really nice. Yeah, it's all of this stuff.
We've only just begun to live. White lace and promises. A kiss for luck and we're on our
every track, For All We Know, Superstar, Rainy Days and Mondays, all the things that you remember from the Carpenters, Goodbye to Love with Steve Lukather, Hurting Each Other, Cliff Richard, I Won't Last a Day Without You. I had to give you a quick compliment on that one. That's one of my favorites right there on the track, because the arrangement there was very R&B jazzy stuff, and that sort
of... It looked really good, and that was the very first one I did. That was the very first song that I recorded on the whole album. So was getting, you know, I actually went back and re-recorded the vocals on that, because I went, you know, when I first started, I was trying to figure out what, you know, where I was going with this. What did I really want to do with this project, and just trying to get in my comfort zone with it. And I did go back and redo the vocals on that, but it is a beautiful track. They did such a great job.
Day after day, I must face a world of strangers where I don't belong. I'm not that strong. It's nice to know that there's someone I can turn to who will always care. You're always there when there's no getting over that rainbow. When my small list of dreams won't come true, I can take all the madness the world has to give, but I won't last a day without you. So many times when the city seems to be without a friendly face, a lonely place, it's nice to know that you'll be there if I need you, and you'll always smile. It's all worthwhile when there's no getting over that rainbow. When my small list of dreams won't come true, I can't take all the madness the world has to give, but I won't last a day without you. Touch me and I end up singing. Troubles seem to up and disappear. You touch me with the love you're bringing. I can't really lose when you're near. If all my friends have forgotten half their promises, they're not unkind, just hard to find. One look at you and I know that I could learn to live without the rest. I found the best when there's no getting over. Dreams won't come true. I can take all the madness the world has to give, but I won't last a day without you. No, I won't last a day without you.
I'm sorry we don't have that much more time to talk, but you know, we'll end it up right now.
We'll just have to do it again.
Well, if you have time, we'll see how this goes. You know, this will make it easier for the edit. But I appreciate you coming on. It's been I'm out of breath now because I was trying to. you can't believe all the little things I skipped. Normally, I don't write down my questions, but I'm glad I did. It was like almost like it was fate. I had to do it this way because I had no idea we were going to have to do this in a half an hour. But you've been very gracious. You're a beautiful lady. It sounds like you the way you talk about your family. You have you are just blessed all the way around.
Absolutely.
What keeps you centered, so that you can keep focused and all that stuff? Are you a woman of faith or anything like that?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Good. I am. And yeah, that is what keeps me grounded and centered. And that's been the biggest thing with everybody asking me. So, you know, what is it that, you know, what's the legacy you want to leave behind with this whole project? Mm-hmm. And just in general in life, and, you know, kindness and goodness is so needed in this world. Music is so needed in this world right now. I feel like if nothing else can bring us together, sometimes music can. And being a good vocalist or being a good songwriter or you know, whatever, that that's all great. But, you know, just being a good person in general. And, you know, my family keep me grounded. My kids keep me focused to kind of just stay in the right track and do good. And so that's really where it all comes from, and from God, of course.
Yeah. Well, thank you. And I hope your kids aren't texting you right now saying, Mom, you got to go now. You got to come and get me, wherever it was. She's got to go, Carla. But let's plug. You have a website, so this is probably the best way to start off, besides, you know, Googling, because there are other Carla Williams. I think you ought to know that. You better pick the right one.
That's right. There are others. Yes.
So it'd be CarlaWilliamsMusic.com.
That's right. CarlaWilliamsMusic.com. And on, and then all over my social media platforms, it's Carla Williams Music.
Yeah. Do you consider yourself country singer or just singer?
I used to be. I started out as a country singer. I feel like that'll always be embedded in me somewhere, but I've done so many other things along the way. So
yeah,
kind of changed that genre a little bit. So
okay,
just singer right now.
Singer. Good. I hope we can do this again.
Absolutely.
I'll get in touch with the publicist, whoever put you in touch with me. And I think this is...
Would love to. Let's
this
do.
This is wonderful. I've been bragging. My wife and I have been talking about you over lunch yesterday. And I was bragging how great your album is. So I hope I got all the questions she wanted. She wanted to know about the, you know, the drums. Did you learn? You had drums lessons, right?
I'm still in the midst of that. Yes, I'm not ready yet, but just, you know, just learning it, you know, and it'll be a part of the show eventually.
Yeah.
When I'm out performing, but yeah, just, you know, learning that and kind of the coordination behind that is insane.
Yes.
So
yeah, I can't imagine that it's easy. Can you sing and play at the same time like Karen used to?
Well, not quite yet. I've got one I can do close to you. That's about the only one that I've gotten so far. So
good. That's the beginner one.
It's baby steps. We'll start slow.
Well, thank you so much. It was a real pleasure to meet you, Carla. I had the jitters because this is like the first show of the new year, and I wanted to be put on a good impression. So I hope I did.
Well, this was wonderful, and I'm sorry that I have to jump off so quick today.
Yeah.
But let's do it again. Would love to.
Please forgive me for keeping you on just a tiny bit longer, but it was worth it for the audience. There's so much more we can talk about next time. I'd love to break some of these tracks down and talk about songwriting a little bit, maybe if you're inclined. But for now,
I'd love to.
Bless you. All the blessings on your family. You have a great one, and I wish all the success for this new album.
Thank you so much. Nice to meet you. I appreciate it.
Take care, Carla. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye now.
You've been listening to StrongWriter on the radio, as heard on the Dean Olsen radio program, and heard all across America on Power Me Up Radio, powered by Raven International.